And welcome back, mes amigos. You're watching the Ahistorical Gamer as we play the original, the best, Hearts of Iron 3. Today we'll be playing a scenario battle as the Spanish Republicans. Historically, the Spanish Republic officially surrendered on the 1st of April 1939, a day which is strangely appropriate given that the Republic essentially fell in 1937, as Stalin had forced the democratic government to disembowel itself in exchange for the armaments needed to ensure its survival. The Spanish Civil War is often portrayed as the dress rehearsal for the Eastern Front of the Second World War. Communists versus fascists. The truth is much sadder and much closer to home. By the 1930s, Spain was not a happy country. It had been defeated in almost every war it had fought for the last 100 years, excepting the nearly 40 coup attempts. The result was grinding poverty and the emigration of 3 million people who had left the country in hope of better lives elsewhere. In 1921, yet another military disaster afflicted the Spanish army. The forces of a tribal rebel, Abd el-Karim of Morocco, inflicted the disaster at Anol. Some 8,000 soldiers and officers were killed or disappeared out of 20,000. While off the coast of Morocco, the battleship España ran aground off the Cape of Tres Forcas. The incompetence of Spanish military command, which had been encouraged by the then king, led to the overthrow of the monarchy and the establishment of yet another Spanish Republic, the Second Republic. When a republic emerged, it was to be a republic of the oligarchic elite rather than a democracy of the people, a situation which pleased no one. On paper, Spain seemed a wealthy country. Spanish exports in. The First World War had caused Spanish GDP to grow massively, but this wealth did not trickle down. Wages increased by only 25%, while at the same time prices of commodities doubled. This situation had a curious effect on the Spanish left. During the First World War, the only way to ensure wage rises had been unionization. These new union movements, however, now posed a potent political force that called for the removal of the oligarchic establishment and its political elite. Contrary to public opinion, however, it was the libertarian anarchist movement that would initially achieve dominance within the hearts and minds of the Spanish peasantry. The moralizing of the Spanish church, now widely viewed as both power-hungry, hypocritical, and corrupt, no longer held sway as it had during the Napoleonic era. And yet the church remained, for many, a source of inspiration and of salvation. The rising militancy among the Catholic faith was fueled not merely by their own intolerance, but also by a rising intolerance amongst the left, who increasingly viewed not just the abandonment of religion on a personal basis, but rather the destruction of all religious institutions as necessary for the building of a new society. Within the politics of the capital, however, a corrupted centrism had emerged. As the historian Antony Beevor put it, whenever there was an unpopular measure to carry out, the conservatives would retire, and the liberals, who had now become almost indistinguishable from their opponents, came in. On witnessing the coup of Benito Mussolini and wishing to preempt a takeover by atheist fascists, a conservative Catholic military officer, Miguel Primo de Rivera, launched a coup of his own, overthrowing the Republic and restoring the monarchy. His promise? To eliminate corruption and regenerate Spain. His vision for Spain, however, was a narrow one, of country, religion, and monarchy. So it was that Primo de Rivera imposed his dictatorship. And then there was the Great Depression. Spain was hit hard. The price of goods and of labor continued to fall as a result of the Depression. As a result, militancy began to spike. The dictator Rivera resigned to prevent bloodshed within Spain, his noblest act in a career of political failure. The restoration of the Third Spanish Republic, however, did little to quiet the discontent of the people. The Spanish army, too, was deeply unhappy with the situation and had narrowly missed out on executing its own coup only due to political rivalry and factionalism within the armed forces itself. Violent methods used by hired thugs to break up labor protests led in turn to violent protest by the left, followed by violent repression by the military, including methods of torture and rape, saw violence become a common feature of political action within Spain. A violent uprising by striking miners in 1934 led to major fears among the right of a brewing left-wing takeover and communist insurrection of the type seen in the Soviet Union. When the right lost the election in 1936, they began to plot their move. The coup would take place. As violent assassinations by both left and right-wing extremists swept across the country, the grand irony was that the fascist and communist parties that each member accused the other of being a part of represented less than 10% of political membership in the entire Spanish nation. Greed, bigotry, arrogance, lack of empathy, and the sinister designs of foreign interests had torn Spain apart. The rise of fascism and communism that both sides had claimed they were fighting against led, in fact, to the creation and entrenchment of fascism and communism as powerful political forces that would eat away at both the nationalists and republicans from within. General Franco and the nationalists, backed by Nazi Germany and Mussolini's Italy, would defeat their republican foes, who had themselves been destroyed by their alliance of desperation with the Soviet Union. But could events have turned out differently? Could the Republic have been saved before Stalin gained control? Let's find out.